Welcome back. We're going to talk about deploying and verifying Azure SQL. Now, as we've kind of alluded to with pre-deployment planning and all the different options, when you actually go and deploy your Azure SQL database or Azure SQL managed instance, there's going to be an order at which you make the various decisions. Now, for this example, we're going to walk through the different blades that you'll actually see if you pick to deploy using the Azure portal. Now, the first blade you're going to see is the basics blade. And this is going to ask things like your subscription, your resource group, and depending on if you're deploying a managed instance or an Azure SQL database, you're going to have to specify the name of the server. Now, this is the first time we're mentioning this idea of a server for Azure SQL database. Now, this server is really more of a logical server or a database server. And the reason we have this is so you can have something to connect to for starters. And also it's going to allow you to group certain databases together and allow for policies over all of those databases in the logical server. We'll try our best to demystify what this logical server actually is and the different capabilities that come along with it throughout the series. Now, once you pick some of your basics, including, you know, the number of vCores and your size, and if you're using Azure SQL Database, if you want to opt in for pools, you're going to go ahead and select your network connectivity. Now, we're going to dive much deeper into this in the security module, but basically, you have to decide what kind of access do you want people to have out the door, and are there any VNet or firewall rules that you need to set up initially? For example, for Azure SQL managed instance, during deployment or before deployment, you can actually configure the exact virtual network and subnet that your managed instance will go into. After that, you are going to have some options for some different settings, depending on which deployment option you choose. You'll see there are some that say DB and some that say MI. And some of these things like data source for Azure SQL Database, you can actually choose to leverage a different database backup or the AdventureWorks sample during deployment. You can also select a few different options. So for example, if you're deploying Azure SQL Managed Instance, you have a choice of the server collation as well as the time zone. And for Azure SQL Database, you can opt in for advanced data security. Advanced data security is available for Azure SQL Managed Instance, just not as part of the deployment workflow. Finally, you can add something called tags. And tags are going to allow you to group resources in Azure together. For example, I might have an environment tag. And for the value for that tag, I might have development or production. And that can help me keep my workloads separate. Finally, you're going to have to accept the terms and privacy, and we encourage you to go read those. It's very similar to the SQL Server EULA, except there are also some key differences related to the Azure Marketplace. Now, after you deploy, you might be wondering, you know, what are some of the key implementation details of what we're doing behind the scenes are?
Yeah, we wanted you to know as you go through the deployment process, you know, how are we deploying things in the Azure infrastructure? So first of all, you should know that everything we do uses the Azure Service Fabric, as every service in Azure does, including virtual machines. And so if you take a look at Azure SQL Managed Instance, one of the reasons why the deployment process can be a little bit longer is we're giving you something called a dedicated ring or virtual cluster as you deploy this instance. And that's so a scale operation or deployment can actually take a little longer than doing something like a database. Now, for most cases, each instance is its own single virtual machine within this cluster. And there could be, depending on the choices you make and how we implement things, there could be multiple virtual machines per a given node as we deploy this instance. Now, we mentioned before in the first module something called instance pools, and that's where we get things a little bit different, where we can pack in more than one instance inside a VM, which gives you those lower vCore choices, and that's why deployment in pools can be a faster operation. Now you look at Azure SQL Database. And as Anna mentioned, we have something called a logical database server and a logical master even. Don't think of this as an actual physical SQL server, although we really do use a SQL server instance behind the scenes to deploy your database. In fact, aside from some smaller choices in the subcore model, say in the D2 model, We deploy a dedicated SQL instance behind the scenes for your Azure SQL database to keep you isolated and performant. And more surface area and instance level diagnostics now light up because we do that. So even though Azure SQL Database is not an instance for you to access, you will use a logical server to make a connection and some metadata associated with your databases as part of that. There still is a SQL instance powering this, which again gives you things like Xevent and certain DMVs that you would not normally have. Then if you think about Hyperscale, it's a very interesting implementation we've done, and we'll show that a little bit more to you as you see our availability module. And even we talk about things like performance. Thing you need to know about really important is today, at least, when you move to Hyperscale, you deploy it, you cannot change that deployment model. That's different than all the other different models we offer in Azure SQL Database. So if you're going to go to Hyperscale, it's important you decide ahead of time that is indeed the model you want to move to. And the caches we provide early in the architecture are really the key to our speed and scalability story. These caches are actual local disk drives that serve as a so-called cache. And because we're in remote storage for the databases, we get really amazing functionality from, say, snapshot backups and restores at lightning speeds. Now, some people have asked me, as you're going through the process of implementing Azure SQL in the service fabric, how do you provide these limits? Well, first of all, you've seen and may have heard of our feature called Resource Governor in SQL Server, which that's going to be exposed to you in managed instance to use on your own. But in Azure SQL Database, for example, we're going to use Resource Governor behind the scenes to provide some limitations based on the deployment choices you made. We're also going to use something called Windows Job Objects. Windows Job Objects are not a scheduling thing. It's a property within the Windows operating system where you can put certain limits on processes. And we'll talk about and show you some examples how Windows Job Objects apply those different resource limits to your deployment choices. We're going to use other things. We're going to use file server resource management. We're going to be able to, within the engine, control transaction log rates to transaction log governance. We're going to take advantage of Azure Storage, which allows you to do limits. And then finally, some of this information from a perspective of a job object is actually exposed at a DMV. You know, in the SQL team, we just love exposing all sorts of details to our customers. And even in the case of Azure, we will give you some exposure to, you know, those kind of type details. So as Anne and I were talking about this series together, she asked me this question. She goes, so when you verify deployment in SQL Server, what do you do, Bob? How do you know it actually got installed? And so what I thought it would be interesting to show you is how I personally would actually verify deployment I've done in Azure. So there's a couple steps we should take a look at. First of all, for managed instance, the one thing I would do is I would check the portal or the CLI. So remember, if you install a SQL Server, you're going to use the SQL Setup program to look at setup logs. Well, with Azure in the ecosystem, I'm going to be able to look at the status of my deployment in the portal. It's going to show me as a deployment. That's why we call it deploy. So a deployment status is going to be shown to you, or the CLI can show that. And we have things called activity logs, which are part of that Azure ecosystem I talked about, that can give you details about how this deployment worked. Now, managed instance like a SQL Server. So I don't know about you, but I always look at my error log. What's inside the error log to see when this finally finished, to see if it installed or deployed successfully? Now I might go connect with SSMS or run some verified deployment queries, which I'll show you in a second. What about for Azure SQL Database? What do I do differently between that and a managed instance? Well, guess what? It's exactly the same, except we don't expose the underlying error logs of the instance to you in Azure SQL Database. So you're going to use the same process that you're going to use with managed instance, though, to do these verified deployment steps. Now, what about connecting with SSMS? You've deployed Azure SQL. You're ready to go. How do I do it? We're going to show you some examples. But you know how simple it can be? Yeah, you get your connection with a network to the internet through its Azure virtual machine, or are you doing it from your own on-premises? You're going to get the name of a server to connect to, whether it's your Azure SQL Database logical server, or it's going to be your managed instance. You're going to use the credentials you supplied during deployment, and you're going to be able to just connect to that Azure SQL Database or managed instance. Now, what I usually do with a SQL Server is I run a few query examples. So these are the kind of queries I run just to kind of check my deployment. Whether it's looking at the version of the deployment, looking at the different databases, like the system databases, looking at various objects to make sure these catalog views are working properly. Now, there's a series of DMVs I often use to look at schedulers or the properties of the operating system, or even just show me the background tasks that are running. I want to make sure Lazy Rider is running on my server. This is going to look very similar to you as a SQL Server deployment with a few differences. You're going to be able to use server property to look at the specific engine edition, which is going to show you Is this a database or is this managed instance versus a SQL server? And then finally, we're going to start showing you in this series how we have some diagnostics that are specific to Azure. And here's a couple examples of some DMVs that we would use that are very specific to the Azure deployment. And we'll show some examples of what that actually looks like. Yeah, just to summarize what we showed you, Anna showed you the deployment experience as though you were in the portal, the different choices you make, just like you were installing a SQL server. Then we talked about some of the implementation details behind the scenes so you can have an idea of how we deploy things within the Azure Service Fabric and the different virtual machine details and how we limit certain resources. And finally, we kind of gave you our perspective of how we would verify deployment, whether that's using activity logs or things within the Azure infrastructure or just running some queries from SSMS to see what this Azure SQL deployment looks like. Looking forward to talking to you in the next video.